Needs to know who Garth Brooks is. I think I'm in way far north and I'm lost. Looking back on the memory of the dance we shared beneath the stars above, for a moment, all the world was right. How could I have known that you'd ever say goodbye? And now I'm glad I didn't know the way it all would end, the way it all would go. Our lives are better left to chance. I could have missed the pain, but I hadn't missed the dance. Holding you, I had everything. For a moment, wasn't I a king? But if I'd only known how the king would fall, he's who's to say, you know, I might have changed it all. And now I'm glad I didn't know the way it all would end, the way it all would go. Our lives are better left to chance. I could have missed the pain, but I'd have had to miss the dance. Doesn't fit in my pocket. You know, this phone's gotten like naturally bigger and bigger and bigger, and I have little tiny kid hands. They don't actually mix very well. Genesis 45. Looking back. So up to this point, we've had Joseph and Joseph's brothers come to him, and he plays tricks on them over and over and over. And he puts one of his brothers in prison. Actually, puts all of them in prison for a little bit, switches that out, puts one in prison for a long bit, and then plays with them again. He threatens to put his youngest brother, Benjamin, who they pretty much put their life on, in prison. And then Judah breaks down. And at the point that Judah breaks down, and asked that he replace his brother, because they figured their father will die if the little brother does not return. We begin in verse 1. Then Joseph could not control himself before all those who stood by him. He cried, "Make everyone go out from me." So no one stayed with him when Joseph made him known to his brothers. And he wept aloud so that the Egyptians heard him, and the household of Pharaoh heard it. And Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still alive?" But his brothers could not answer him, for they were dismayed at his presence. So Joseph said to his brothers, "Come near to me, please." And they came near, and he said, "I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here, for God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land these 2 years, and there are yet 5 years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvesting. And God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on the earth, and to keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me a father to Pharaoh, and lord of all his house, and ruler over all the land of Egypt. Hurry and go to my father and say to him, 'Thus says your son Joseph, God has made me lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, do not tarry. You shall dwell in the land of Goshen, and you shall be near me, you and your children, your children's children, and your flocks, your herds, and all that you have. There I will provide for you, for there are yet 5 years of famine to come, so that you and your household and all that you have do not come to poverty. And now as your eyes see, and the eyes of my brother Benjamin see, that it is my mouth that speaks to you. You must tell my father of all my honor in Egypt, and of all that you have seen. Hurry and bring my father down." Then he fell upon his brother Benjamin's neck and wept, and Benjamin wept upon his neck. And he kissed all of his brothers and wept upon them. After that, his brothers talked with him. When the report was heard in Pharaoh's house, "Joseph's brothers have come," it pleased Pharaoh and his servants. And Pharaoh said to Joseph, "Say to your brothers, 'Do this, load your beasts and go back to the land of Canaan, and take your father and your household and come to me, and I will give you the best of the land of Egypt. And you shall eat the fat of the land. And you, Joseph, are commanded to say, do this. Take wagons from the land of Egypt for your little ones and for your wives, and bring your father and come. Have no concern for your goods, for the best of all the land of Egypt is yours.'" He begins by Joseph. Last week we were talking about how terrible a person he really was. How he's just picking at his brothers and picking at his brothers and picking at his brothers and acting like it's full of bread. And this week he says something that I don't know if he just figured it out, or it was there the whole time and he just didn't put 200 together. He says, "You didn't do it." He said, "All these things that happened to me, you didn't actually do it." We read in the story where they first try to throw him in a well and let him die, and then they pull him out of the well and sell him. There's no question who did it. There's no question that it is the brothers who put him in the well. It is the brothers who sell him. And yet we understand that God was working out something much bigger in the middle of everything. And I started with that poem, song, of looking back. And that idea that Ralph said it really well. Sometimes the terrible comes. And he said, right then and there we're still blessed. And what's weird is, for Joseph to be able to figure out that through all those things he was blessed. Through all those things that God was actually working, to actually look back on his life and go, you know, at the time I thought that was pretty terrible. I mean, how many of us are volunteering for the life of Joseph? Come on, there's some pretty good points, right? You get to be sold into slavery. That's an upper. Right? Then you get to be carried away to a country you have no idea about, I've never seen, with people that look funny, and you look funny to them. Then you're going to prison. Come on, somebody volunteer. We've got to have some crazies in here. Okay, all they're saying, no word. But the truth is, he says, but God did all this to then save. He did all that to save our remnant, as he says. He did all that to rescue his people. And if Joseph can do that, spoiled brat Joseph, why are we not more quick to think like this? Because we get in the middle of something, and the worst thing we can do is, focus. And better yet, we'll be having a really good day, right? We have a really good day, and there's something 3 days from now, and we are dreading it so bad we're making ourselves sick. We're even having a good day. Today, right now, will be excellent, and we're thinking, oh, in the future, what if, what if, what if, what if, what if, what if? And we're so convinced that we want to see the dance, as Garth Brooks says it. But the problem is, we only take one step at a time. We only live one day at a time. We don't know the dance. We don't know how the chips will fall. We don't know how anything's going to go. And we can focus on the negative, or we can do what Joseph did with his life in our lives. Because we'll look back at the negative and we may be dealing with a loss. A lot of this congregation are. And you have to ask yourself, would you have rather not danced? Would you rather have danced? Would you rather have done what you've done and enjoyed the moments? And look back today and say, I remember that moment, that was amazing. To look back and say, that was really good. Or we can do a lot of the norm and look back and go, well, I'm thinking about this one event. And a common thing in counseling is to focus on the death of someone, the loss of someone. And one of the greatest things that anyone can do is to talk about it. Because in the middle of this, he's looking back at some terrible events. I mean, we've got slavery in prison, and I'm not really able to name a lot worse ones. And he's looking back at it, and he's saying, God was moving right there. They were blessings right there. And, but if you look back at the story, you're going to see that there were blessings right there. Do you notice he gets put in prison? He gets put in the captain's guards prison. He's sitting with the chief cupbearer. He's sitting with the chief baker. He's not in the lowest prison. If there's a positive, he's not in the lowest prison. He's sold to slavery. Potiphar, the guard. He is a slave to one of the highest officials. His life was probably better than a lot of free people in Egypt. Because he is in Potiphar's household. And then he comes to the end, and it's real easy for us to get to the end and go, I see God right there. I see God at the end, because you know who Pharaoh is? Pharaoh's second. Only in name is Pharaoh greater than Joseph. Joseph runs the show, and Pharaoh just happy to get along. And we can look at the end and we can go, how great is it here? But we can forget that in the middle of it, there's so much being rescued for us. There's so much being kept for us. And we can have a Joseph story that ends with Pharaoh right here. And we're looking at this, and this looks good, right? He's sending wagon loads. He's like, go get your father, but don't just go get him. Go send wagon loads. Bring him a bunch of stuff so he'll actually believe you. So that when his brothers actually go, the father's back to go, quit messing with him. Your brother's just like you, you know, quit messing with him. But he doesn't do that. He sends wagon loads. Verse 21, he's going to do exactly that. The sons of Israel did so, and Joseph gave them wagons according to the command of Pharaoh, and gave them provisions for the journey. To each and all of them he gave a change of clothes, but to Benjamin he gave 300 shekels of silver and 5 changes of clothes. To his father he sent as follows: 10 donkeys loaded with good things in Egypt, 10 female donkeys loaded with grain, bread, and provisions for his father on the journey. Then he sent his brothers away, and as they departed, he said to them, do not quarrel on the way. So they went up out of Egypt and came to the land of Canaan to their father Jacob. And they told him, Joseph is still alive, and he is ruler over all the land of Egypt. And his heart became numb, and he did not believe them. But when they told him all the words of Joseph, which he had said to them, and when he saw the wagons that Joseph had sent to carry him, the spirit of their father Jacob revived, and Israel said, it is enough. Joseph, my son, is still alive. I will go and see him before I die. And we end with this beautiful story that still has Joseph being Joseph. An advantage to studying someone like Joseph is we don't have to go, when we study Christ, it's so easy to go, well, he's Christ, he can do that. I mean, when we look at Christ, it's so easy to go, I mean, he's Messiah, he's God, he's the Son of God, he's all this stuff, and just, you know, kind of take a back seat. He's perfect, I'm not. And it becomes a cop-out. But when we look at Joseph, even now we can say, well, Joseph is looking back and focusing and saying, God was still with me right here. And we can look at Joseph and we go, oh, he sounds like he's pretty perfect at this point. Okay, spoil little Brad Joseph, are you ready? To each of them, he gave a change of clothes. But to Benjamin, Benjamin's his brother, he's the youngest, he gives 300 shekels of silver and 5 changes of clothes. Not that anybody's showing favorites right now. I mean, these guys, your worthy brothers, they got a change of clothes. And there was much rejoicing. And then he's like, you're my little brother, you get 500 shekels of silver. So Joseph has not gone from being Joseph, the spoilt little brat, the one who thinks that his mother is the favorite, so he's the best. But in the middle of that, somebody like Joseph gets a blessing. Joseph, who doesn't give up on God through pretty much the worst situation we can think of getting ourselves into, and being challenged by someone who is not a good role model. I know, if anybody starts acting like Joseph, or your elders will talk to you, trust me. If you start going, well, everybody gets a cookie, except you get the whole box, and then, you know, I'm going to give you $100. You're my favorite. If anybody acted like Joseph, we would be upset that you were acting like Joseph. But when we take somebody who's imperfect like that, and yet relies on God, we understand something about God that we sometimes neglect to put through. We neglect to put through that God is with us and God can do great things with us. I mean, if God can use spoiled brat Joseph, who started out getting into trouble because he was flaunting his coat, who gets in trouble for his pride, and then at the end does not seem to have fixed it very well. This Joseph, who is imperfect, and yet God uses him to save the remnant of Israel. Because without Joseph, there is no Judah. Without Judah, there is no Messiah. Without a Messiah, this is all pointless. And God uses extremely imperfect people that still have problems. And this is one of the best to show you, because a lot of people, they come to God and they get so much better. We see that. We see their response. You know, we have Saul of Tarsus, right? Terrible, breathing fire, killing people. Like, this is just a bad dude. But then he comes to Christ and we see this beautiful changeover. He's now Paul. Okay. I'm more like Peter. You know the story of Peter? Peter comes. You know, he starts out okay. And he comes to Jesus, and you know, he follows Jesus, and you know, rubber meets the road, and he jumps ship. Denies Jesus 3 times. Jesus brings him back in, talks to him, he says, "Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me?" And he's like, "Yes, yes, yes." And then we're like, well, Peter's got it going smooth now. Until we hear about Paul rebuking Peter. And he says that he is neglecting the Gentiles so that he can act like a Jew. Peter, this apostle of Christ, gets rebuked by Paul, who says, yeah, you're trying to bring them back to Judaism. You're trying to make the Jews better than the Gentiles again. And we see in Peter this very imperfect person who has helped leading the church. Who has helped. And he is being used by God. And just between those two, I want you to think about your life. I want you to make this very personal fact. In your life, what is it that you say that you've got that God can't use? What is it that's so terrible at you that you're struggling with that God can't use? Because I hope I have built up the fact of how bad Joseph is. And right here we realize he hasn't changed much. And if we can honestly get past the fact that I'm not perfect is no longer an excuse. And I love how Hebrews says it. Hebrews talks about if you act willfully. The phrase, if you sin willfully, there remains no more sacrifice. It's not a perfectionism as in, I'm going to be perfect, but I'm not going to sin. It's a perfectionism as in, I'm going to strive for perfection. A Christianity that says, you know what, I still struggle with stuff. I still struggle with issues. But I understand that God could use Joseph. How many of y'all honestly would say you think it'd be okay to imprison your brother? I'm not kidding. Like, you're just like, hey, buddy, I'm going to rat you out. I'm going to frame you and put you in jail. This is Joseph. Don't forget, he frames his brother. He literally puts the stuff in his sack and then goes, see, he's a thief. See, he stole from me. No, I'm going to put him in prison. They're spies. Calls him spies, puts him in prison. All these different things he does, and yet none of us would even start to think about doing that. Some of you may have an enemy that you would like to put in prison. None of you have done it yet. And he did. So could you imagine Joseph getting up here and telling you his story, and you just being like, you're a dark individual. You are a sick, twisted individual. God wouldn't use you. Because if we take our subject out of our story for a second, we're going to look at this person and we're going to say, Joseph, you're not getting used by God. God's going to use people who've got it together. Not people who are messed up and screwed up and really so Joseph needs to be you. Joseph needs to be you because I want you to see how this ends. It ends with Joseph being blessed extremely. Joseph being blessed, being used by God, and the story can continue in Scripture. The story of Israel can come true because guess what? Israel's end is just about God. The end of Israel. And every time we get these blinders on, or we tell God we can't do it, or we say we're limited, or we say we're too sinful, I want you to really remember this one part. I want you to remember one thing tonight. Is that fair? One sentence. Joseph put his brothers in prison. Okay. Joseph put his brothers in prison. Let's try this. I only want you to get 1 point tonight, okay?
Joseph put his brothers in prison.
That was pretty close, right? Hey, let's try it. Who?
Joseph.
What did he do? So the next time we think about God using people, we need to remember this one fact. Joseph put his brothers in prison. Still got used by God. Not because he did anything wrong, because he generally wanted to put his brother in prison. And this can be a start of something great in your life. It can be a start of something amazing where you say, if God uses Joseph, he can use me. If God is going to rescue the nation, he could use me if he wanted to. If God is going to grow the church, he could use me. If God is going to do anything, I have no excuse anymore. Because you don't. Because if God gives you 90 years and you say, I'm 83, guess what you've just done? Tried to steal 7 years that still belong to him. Well, I'm too old. My favorite is, I'm too young. Well, Timothy was told about that one. Let no one look down on you. But set an example of conduct and love. And no matter what our excuse becomes, I'm too sore, I'm too sick, I'm too anything, guess what? There's always something to be done. There's always some way you could reach out. My favorite is, I heard these stories of these shut-ins reaching people for Christ. You know what they used? A telephone. It's a new invention, I get it. And so they pick up these phones and they just call people. But they're shut-ins. They don't even go to church. Right? That's one of our standards. They don't even go to church. But they're picking up their phone and sharing Jesus. I remember serving communion one day, and I almost broke down crying serving communion because there was this man. I handed him communion, and he spilled half the juice. He didn't care. He honestly wanted to be there and didn't care who saw him shake. And he shook violently. In Parkinson's, he shook. He had a lot of other problems, and yet he was there, sitting there, and you could hear it. This is one of them older churches with the pews that will thump if you do it just right. And it was thumping. You could hear it. And he was there. And he's the same one who, when we were trying to go from college to there, he kept slipping a little something in somebody's pocket. Making sure that we had gas money to bring in buses. So that we would go to church. And that's a man who had problems. If you ask him to speak, generally you work and understand most of what he said. And you're telling me a person like that can serve God, and yet we are so good at making excuses. We're good at making excuses, and a man honestly, I tried to talk to him after. I have no idea what he said. He shakes too much. Too many nerves are gone. I didn't understand this stuff. But he knew that he got money and he helped people get to church. Because he figured this out, that it doesn't take a bunch of perfect people. It takes people doing what they can and then combined it working. This fits what we're going through right now. I know a lot of people showed up. And one of the ones that surprised me, that I'm still surprised by, but you know Wayne was old. I wish I actually knew he was old. I didn't know this. I thought he looked 50-something. The other day they told me he was old, and I was like, no, he's not. I've seen him work. He crawled under a building with me. Obviously, people don't crawl under buildings at all. They crawl under buildings at middle. Great to look at someone like that. And I love looking at Wayne because doesn't stop helping you. Wayne worked all last week. Then you know what he did yesterday? Shows up with a giant sign he just felt like doing. He's like, I told you I'd do it. I was going to do it. He did it. I was just thinking, man, I would really love to sleep this morning. He shows up at 8 o'clock, and he looks at the house, and it looks trashed. And I was like, yeah, I haven't been here yet. And all I wanted to do was sleep. And he shows up, and he's like, I already built this sign for you. He brought it over from Meadow Bridge. Because Wayne has something that, I mean, I wish we could all get. Is that we have something to offer God. And we have a lot that we can offer God. And if we really believe that, who cares about this story? This one's dumb. This is a dumb story in comparison to things we could do. Neat. Okay, your second Pharaoh, you're about to get your whole nation of Israel in trouble because they'll forget about you. And our story could be that of how you took somebody and you taught them. That a million years from now, a billion years from now, that same person is rejoicing with the Father, and you did that. That same person is spending eternity with God, and you know what? You get to be blamed. Because you did whatever you could do. You said, I'm imperfect. You said, I have problems. You said whatever you wanted to. And at the end of the day, you say, I don't care. I'm going to serve God in spite of the problems. I'm going to serve God in spite of the excuses that are easily accessible to me. Wayne's son told me of a story the other day. Talked about some middle-aged man telling Wayne that he was too old to work. Think about this middle-aged man telling an older man he's too old to work. It obviously was a fun story and kind of funny. Because the guy says, you know, I'm such and such years old. And Wayne goes, I have a few years on you. And then he tells him it's 20. How terrible is that, though? And tonight, there's a world out there that in spite of everything we can reach, that in spite of whatever your problems are, whatever your sin is, whatever your struggles are, you can save the world like Joseph. You can save that remnant that saves the world. To this, we go back to the Great Commission. And I want you to see who is invited into this Great Commission. Jesus came and said, then all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching to them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, to the end of the age. That includes today. That includes an invitation today for us to go out and change the world because you know what? I can never imprison my brother. Because in spite of everything, God still used Joseph. Tonight we have an invitation to one respond to the kind of love offered by God to us who are people imperfect, who are people immoral, or people who are sick. And he offers us that opportunity to believe in him, to repent of that wickedness that we are. To confess him as Lord, to be buried with him in baptism and raised to new life. So that one day we will live with him. And in this life, have life abundantly through his Holy Spirit. And then we get to serve on the other side, right? Go and make those disciples. Go and use them like God has already given us. That belongs to him in the first place. To reach others. If there's anybody tonight who needs prayers, or anybody who wishes to submit to the eldership here, yes, you come now as we sing and as we sing.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood.